will. Now, the engagement. Engagement is not only a physical assignment of the job to an employee. It is also a psychological aspect. And when we say psychological, some softer issues like recognition, listening to me, and the heart, these are the few factors which is affecting the engagement of the individuals. Like there was a discussion that we can engage, it depends on the capability of an individual also. Not only, suppose a person is completing the task in 2 hours, others are completing in 4 hours. Now they can also be engaged by giving them some value assignments, like do something for the brand work as a brand ambassador of the organization. They can write the blogs, etc. So there are so many ways we can affect the engagement level, and we can enhance the engagement level. And it is like simply ek jar mein pehle bade ball dale gaye, iske baad chote dale gaye, iske baad chote aur dale gaye, beech mein ret dali gayi, iske baad mein pani dala gaya, aur iske baad bhi usme space bacha hua tha. Means there is no limit. We can enhance the engagement level. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So a quick comment, since engagement is a very important, very critical lever, so any quick comment, maybe 30 seconds comment from other groups.
So so I'll just say one more point out of which came out in this group discussion. They say that engage people,
yes.
The three aspects we say that say, stay, and strive. So people who are engaged, they talk about organization people, and they stay a little longer, and they strive for better things. So that's one, three word. Also,
sure.
Tool came, 3 years.
So let me also bring another contrarian view here. Yeah. All of us have read in the text, in the research, that engaged employees drive business results. Or the units, or the teams, or organizations where there is a higher level of engagement, the business results will be superior. There is also another research, and I know Adil has been very passionate about that element as well, that many a times, higher business results could also drive higher levels of engagement. Adil, you want to talk about that? I remember you talking about this, stretching about this, or anything you, or any thought you want to share. Can we have a mic, please, there? I think, Sina Saab, yes.
Just wanted to take a minute's time to say that what a big fraud we are perpetuating on businesses, because we have made engagement a kind of a business activity for the HR department, telling the businesses that we need to work on engagement, because the moment you have an engaged employee, productivity will be high, they'll be doing great job, they'll be performing well, and we'll give you results. Unfortunately, sufficient amount of international research by prime business schools is indicating that there is no direct correlationship of efficiency between engagement levels and performance and productivity levels, including their stock pricing. There is nothing that is a correlationship. That means you will find companies where there are highly engaged employees, but the business is not performing and delivering. You will find companies where the correlationship is positive. You will find companies that the correlationship is negative, and you will find companies that there's no correlationship at all. Therefore, to conclude that engagement leads to this logical patterning is currently under question, which is why everyone is saying there has to be something much more than only engagement.
Absolutely. I think that's a great... please give a big round of applause to Adil. So the point that is being made is concluding that A is always right, or a particular philosophy or belief is always right and concluded beyond doubt is itself a questionable one.
Mr. Singh was saying in the morning, don't think that the mono
is. Absolutely, absolutely, fantastic. Now, let's go to the other groups, and I think we'll start in this reverse order. So this group debated the whole area of values, culture, competencies, so important and so varied. Any thoughts around this area from this topic, Sina Saab or anyone? Be sharp, to the point, quick. Yes, please. Yes.
So I would like to sum up the discussions that we had on, primarily we could focus on culture only. We didn't have time much for competency and development. Of course, we did talk about competency-based culture. So some of the issues which are very relevant and which are some of the of them which are challenging also is cultures. Of course, it's agreed by set by the top management. And when there's change in leadership, the cultures also change. So in one case, in a multinational company, the leadership changed, the new chairman came, and there were new, but the positive thing about it was he articulated the new culture and he defined the new culture which the organizations adopted. So, and of course, one thing which was pointed out by a very seasoned HR professional is the problems in integrating culture in the case of acquisitions and mergers, which HCL faced, and even the, after so many years, they're trying to figure it out how they will. And we have got examples of the Mercedes-Benz and an American automobile company, and they, that you know, marriage did not work out. So that's another issue. Then it's So that's another point. And so in some organizations, very recent joinee in the HR department, she is facing problems about, you know, kind of values which are we can call it negative, arrogance and you know, aggressiveness is rewarded in terms of promotions and all that. So how do you change that kind of culture? So that's a big challenge. And hierarchies are a barrier to setting good cultures, as was pointed out by my colleague there, because lower down the line, many people don't know what is expected of them, and the top management doesn't know what kind of kinds of problems they are facing, and no effort is made to diffuse those problems. So those were the kinds of issues. If anybody wants to add to that in our group discussion, you could do that.
So let me ask a question to the group, and maybe this can also be commented upon by the others. There is a beautiful phrase, and a lot of people talked about it, about culture and the values, that values drive value. Values of the organization drive value. And I'll give an example, live example. Way back in 2009, one pharma company got acquired by another multinational company. Indian pharma company acquired by a big multinational pharma company. The reason it could realize 27 times the EBITDA value was largely attributed to the values of the organization, because the acquiring company said, this is the only organization we have seen in our target list whose values are aligned to our values. So the power of values. Any other comment about culture, values, and the competencies before we move to the next one?
Of course, this group was sufficiently, considerably enriched by presence of Adil Bhai in this group. Adding to what he said, there is a considerable research, as you said. Digitalization succeeds only because of good culture. Otherwise, it becomes the biggest bottleneck in digitalization.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Can you imagine the plight that people in organizations who have the mandate to decide the digital agenda for the company at the top are themselves digitally crippled?
Absolutely, yes.
They are digitally inadequate. How will they decide the strategy? They have no clue. But they have the money, power, position to decide the future. Now you see the problem.
Absolutely. In fact, very recently there was an article in McKinsey which said that about $1 trillion is the overall budget of all the digital initiatives, and the success rate of all these initiatives is not more than 38%. That's the global data. That's research. And one reason what they identified as the reason of failure is the resistance and the lack of buy-in at the top level. So Adil, that's an absolutely bang on point that you made. Yes, Akhil, you want to share something? Can we get the mic, please, there for Akhil?
Thank you, sir. Hi, Rajan. How are you? Interesting comment. That sale gentleman, I forgot, missed his name. Who is the gentleman from sale in this table? Ashok. Ashok, you made a good point about engagement, that at the grassroots level. And and I feel have a very strong viewpoint, and I'll share later on also, that engagement is the only method of creating. Is the mic okay?
Yes, it is working.
Okay. And it's only method of ensuring continuity of business. And with due respect to Adil, like we often disagree on many things. I don't know which research you are referring to, sir, but there's a research which was done as recent as April or May that said disengaged employees contribute to almost one third of the business downfall. One third.
Yes.
Which, how old is that? Right, Michigan is far away from here. I'm talking about somewhere very close to our heart. So Adil, we'll always disagree like this.
Okay, thank you, Akhil. So moving on, well, actually what makes us strong is the diversity of the thought process we have. Just imagine if all of us thought alike. I repeat, if all of us thought alike, we'll be nothing more than one person repeated 300 times. So the diversity is the beauty of the whole thing. Moving to the next group, this group debated the whole point of health, happiness, and well-being. So any quick comments around that anyone wants to go? Yes. Quick, sharp, to the point, focused.
Yeah, hi, my name is Alwyn, and I represent a company called Talent Tattoo. So as a group, of course, we all agree that health, happiness, and well-being has to be a very integral part of every organization, big or small. There are a couple of interesting thoughts which came out during our discussion. One was that happiness is also a state of mind, right? It's more within you. So irrespective of the environment around you, if you're happy from within, you will be happy, irrespective of whatever culture of the organization or whichever environment you're working in, you will find happiness, right? So that's one of the thoughts. Second, happiness is also very relative, right? So some people might be more happy at home. Some people might be more happy in office as well, right? So that is one of the strong points which came. The third, of course, is that the whole initiative of health, happiness, and well-being has to be driven from the top of the organization, because that's where the values are driven, the culture is created, because it directly impacts things like productivity and retention. So those are a few of the points, but I'm sure if there are people who want to contribute more.
Okay, any specific point? Yes, Mamtaji, yes, sharp, to the point, and focused.
Well, my name is Rahul Singh. I'm from IIM Sirmour. So the discussion went very well. We were able to, come up to, consensus that yes, happiness is driven from inside, and an organization can do a lot for an employee to, bring up to the employee's happiness level to its maximum. And since this is a discussion which is open to all the groups, I would like to, weave in other point of view as well, because during our discussion, we definitely came up to the point where employee engagement was emphasized upon. And as this was discussing about employee engagement, how important that is for driving happiness also, it's a very key factor. And apart from that, these kinds of employee engagement that we are, following within organizations are obviously in sync with the values that groups were discussing about. Because if an organization's values are not in sync with that of the employee, as we also discussed, a certain amount of, disparity will be there within the mind of the employee as well, apart from, and also the HR that we're talking about, because it's the key responsibility for an HR to maintain the certain level of happiness. And definitely we cannot achieve it to the maximum, but what we do is strive to achieve the best amount of utility, or the state of mind, as we rightly said, for an employee. So basically that was the conclusion that we came upon. Thank you.
Big round of applause to the team.
One more point to add, sir. Just one point that we wish to add.
Yeah.
All of it has already been covered. But at the end of the day, as Adil mentioned in the morning, we're born with our emotions. So
yes.
If we are allowed to be ourselves, if we are viewed holistically back at work, if we don't have to wear two facades at work, at home, and be different people, So at the end of the day, if we are ourselves, we are definitely happy and we can do things and drive initiatives to be, to make our people happy and be themselves at work.
In fact, your thought triggers another thought I want to quickly share. It kind of synergizes the concept of diversity, uniqueness, your unique strengths, and how does it play out on the organization impact. If you did something on a particular day for long number of hours, very, very long number of hours, and if you enjoyed, that probably is your natural talent. And if you did something for a very short period of time which you did not enjoy, probably that created a lot of stress in your mind, it may be possible that maybe that may not be an area of your strength. And what you are saying, each one is unique. I think as HR professionals, we could also look at the entire canvas from that angle also. Thank you. Very. Absolutely. Thank you. Moving to the next one. So the group dealt with the question of technology. Yes, please. Very quick, sharp, to the point. Less of theory, more of specifics.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. So my name is Angela, and I'm from New Delhi Institute of Management. So in our discussion, the major discussion was that by coming of technology, is the human concept being lost? Because in processes, when we include technology, for example, robotics, when we include robot for the selection and recruitment, is the human concept being lost? If I am employing some employee and I am suggesting him to for some suggestions, if I'm not actually talking to them, then how can I know what are they feeling? And I think the major problem of technology that we all are facing is that we are accepting technology as a challenge rather than as a new opportunity. Because when we are in our school or graduation, we are not actually adapting the technology. I think we should adapt technology from the earlier years. For example, in primary education, in 10th and in 12th, we can include computers as a major subject so that not in today's time, engineers are accepting technology more oftenly rather than from any commerce or arts background, because I think they're more proficient with it. So we should accept technology much more earlier.
Okay, great ideas. Yes.
Talking about your group discussions or your own?
Sir, group discussions.
Okay, let me just quickly ask slightly different questions, and maybe Runa, you can respond to this. Quite often there is this debate of balancing between high tech and human touch. So Runa, you want to make a comment on that? How do you kind of achieve that sense of balance? Because that's a question which many of us, you know.
Thank you, Prem. I think our group also highlighted that beautifully, that when we talked about the linkage between HR and technology, entire group, we had half of them and millennial and experts are sitting there, and everyone agreed that, you know, the HR, human resource, when we talk about, first thing is definitely on the driving front is how do you do personal touch. But, and all of us agreed in a way that technology is an enabler, it's a mediator, it's the processes and application, etc., make it more efficient. And we always would give importance to the personal touch and ensure that we don't lose at all that, you know, one-to-one conversation and one-to-one energy. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Big round of applause to you. Yes, quick one.
Yeah, Premlata from NTPC. So we have to be a bit careful while selecting the process where we have to introduce technology. And we also discussed the levels where the technology will be useful and where the human part is required. So both the things are important, but the balancing and very carefully selecting the process are important.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay.
So Prem, going back to the point that you made yesterday, where example you gave about speed reading.
Yes.
So the point that came up here is, how do you use technology to identify strengths of an individual and then work on those strengths for the multiplier effect to happen in the corporate world
Very
once
good.
You have used the technology?
Mm-hmm. Very good. Yes, please.
So I will be very quick. The only thing that I wanted to emphasize is technology is an enabler. And what you asked us to highlight was the two impact processes. So from an organization standpoint, what is more important is understanding the business imperatives. Each organization will have a very different need, and basis that, that classification of use of technology can be defined. So just quickly doing it, small scale, large scale. Small scale will have a talent acquisition and the ERP where the focus would be more from a technology standpoint. In the large scale scenarios with multiple COEs, I feel most of the organizations are now looking at emphasizing on the base of the pyramid. So TA team will require technology at its core and getting supplemented by TND team, where particularly the L&D part of it, if I want to distinguish, then yes, different functions, but the L&D team would primarily be using technology to ensure that the workforce is enabled to take on the real day challenges which come out of the blue moon. People are not prepared, new technology coming in every day. So these are two areas where large scale, small scale classification of technology use can be done.
Okay, good. Thank you. A big round of applause to the team. So coming back to the last one, the team dealt with the question of changing landscape of the talent.
Hi, Arun here. So I know we are the last, so I'll try to be as brief as possible. So we discussed that as organizations, have we created too many filters for what classifies as our talent and for mobility of that particular talent? So that filter may be age, that filter may be education, that filter may be gender or anything else. And now, talent wants fluidity. So if I was recruited as an engineer or an HR fellow, and if I want to experience sales or if I want to experience purchase, commercial, anything else, how as organizations can we facilitate this mobility? And how as organizations, based on the age, we can reskill people, those skills which are currently necessary for them to move on to the next step, rather than leave them behind the curve and get new people in. Now, it also means that a lot of people who have a predominant function, can organization create a space where, like, let's say 80% of my job is HR, 20% I want to do sales, I can be given certain responsibility of that area. Facilitate cross-functional teams, engage talent and in their mobility. So this was the major points of discussion which we had at our team here.
Very importantly, thank you for sharing that. Just a very specific example, the other day we were having a chat that today, one of the very important skill that was never noticed 10 years ago is your ability to reach out to people, connecting with the people, aggregating people, you know, using social media. And we were talking about the example of Runa, that she does it so flawlessly well. So then we said this is also one of the skills that all of us need to acquire. And I mean, it's a choice all of us have. Those who acquire this skill faster, they will be even more effective. Those who do not, probably their effectiveness will be to that extent relatively lower. So the level of skills, the kind of skills that we need today is probably very different compared to. So I think that's the essence of what you discussed. So thank you so much. So any quick comment from Dr. Singh from your side? You want to? No? OK. So we are.
Can I just take one thing? Just one point. It was there in my mind which I wanted to share.
30 seconds mein ho jayega.
Less than that. Charity begins
you are
at
between
home.
The lunch and the. Yes, go
charity,
ahead.
Charity begins at home. So okay. Individually, everybody needs to be enabled on technology, on culture, on engagement across the board.
Sure.
That is what I wanted to make.
Thank you. Thank you. So. Okay, so I think we had a good discussion. Alok, do you want to make some comment from anything from your side?
Okay, just a quick one. I thought the level of engagement we had and the kind of conversation that happened was absolutely so meaningful and purposeful. The key continued to be the balance between technology and the human touch. And I think in no way by use of technology the idea is that the human touch is going to be compromised or diluted. So that's all I wanted to just quickly reinforce.
Okay. Rajiv, anything from your side? Rajiv, any comment from your side?
I think we had a very engaged discussion on art because it flew right from the stage to this place. Happiness was already being discussed. So everybody was geared up for discussing the happiness thing. We shared a lot of experiences and we did deliberate a lot on the connect between wellness, happiness, and how can we enhance that. One thing we also have discussed is that we all come from very different kind of industries and we were just deliberating that one formula will not fit everywhere. So every industry has to be, it works differently. The ethos is different, the culture is different.
Absolutely.
So everything is different in every kind of industry. So, but we must learn from each other. We did pick up some gems from people. They have really done well within their organizations.
Right.
So in very engaged discussion, we wished that we had more time because we didn't get the opportunity. Everybody was feeling that we could have spoken more. But I think the format brought out the best in a short possible, shortest possible time. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. Prasoonji, any thoughts from your side? You had a group which was debating a very important topic.
So idea was to engage. So yes. It's organizational excellence through technology, talent, and all. So everything is happening around talent. So, and we had a very nice session. Nothing much to say. We got people. A lot of things came out. People shared their ideas. They got engaged. They talked to each other. It's a platform where they connected with each other. They know better themselves now. That's one thing which I liked about it. And I don't know. Someday we will come out with whatever they have shared, and they can give it back to you.
So thank you. So what we'll do also, and it's a request to all the moderators, whatever was discussed at your table, if you could make out half a page summary, just the specific points, not too much of a construct in terms of the concept, specific points, half a page summary. If all of you can share with Harendra, are you around? Harendra? Yes, Dhananjayji, if you can. So if you can share this with Dhananjayji, and he will then share with all the participants, so that every participant will have the complete summary of everything that happened during the last one plus hour. Okay? Taali baja sakte ho to khul ke bajao. Taali bajane mein koi kanjosi karne ki avashyakta nahi hai. Thank you. I would also like to acknowledge that in this initiative, Rubaru is the third year that we are doing. So this is the third year we have done Rubaru. I think every year we have been raising bar in terms of overall process, construct, and design. And I would like to acknowledge the contribution of my friend Murli and Dr. VP Singh, because they were the people who challenged me this time, ki Prem is bar alag kya kar rahe ho. So I think I would like you all to give them a big round of applause. Finally, I would also like to compliment my EC team. Alok ji is here, Prasoon ji is here. Mamta, can you, So this beautiful lady and these two gentlemen also deserve a big round of applause, please. Because they were the people who have provided their input